Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to Mount Carmel Baptist Church Online Edition. Appreciate you tuning in. We're going to have a Bible study for you each Wednesday night. We have two sermons on Sundays. We post those at our normal times, worship times, so you'll be able to find our videos for Sunday morning at 10:30. You'll find Sunday night's video posted at 6 on our Facebook page. You'll find our Bible study for Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock on Wednesdays. We post those to our church's Facebook page as well as to our YouTube channel. Mount Carmel Maryville is our YouTube channel. You can look that up. You can even put YouTube on the big screen watching on your TV if you've got that capability. Well, tonight I want to talk to you about the Word of God. We started this last week, last Wednesday night, talking about the sufficiency of Scripture last week. Is the Bible all that we need to know God and to live a life pleasing to Him? And what we find is that indeed it is. The Bible is all we need to know God and to live a life pleasing to Him. I want to continue on looking at the Word of God, and it is my hope that in this time of uncertainty that you grow in your confidence in the Bible and use it as an anchor for your soul and a rock on which to build your life. Listen to what the Bible says here. Paul tells this to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. He says this: "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." That's 2 Timothy 3:16 and verse 17. And Paul is speaking there about the Bible and the fact that the Bible is the inspired Word of God. So as we talk about the Bible being an authority for our life, now let me rephrase that, the authority for our life. Above all other authorities, the Bible is the Word of God, and we take it as our authority for truth in this life. So why do we believe that? Now, why do we hold to that? Well, to understand that, we have to start with the idea of inspiration. And let me start off by saying that I believe in what is called the verbal plenary inspiration of Scripture. Verbal meaning the very words, and plenary meaning the sum or the total. So what we believe is this: that the very words of Scripture are inspired by God, the phrases of Scripture are inspired by God, and the sum total of the Bible is the inspired Word of God. The parts and the whole, all of it, is the inspired Word of God. Now, I need to tell you about a second understanding that we have here, and that is the word inspiration. Because people use the word inspiration sometimes to describe maybe a painter, an artist, a songwriter, and someone was inspired to write a song. Well, they use that in a more general sense, meaning something gave them an idea. We're not talking about using your own power and a creative idea came to you and you used your own power to come up with it. That is not how the Word of God came to be. We believe that the Word of God is inspired in a unique way, unlike any other book anywhere in history. And it is the Word of God, and the Bible alone is the Word of God, nothing else added to it. So the Bible talks about inspiration, and it tells us that it came about in several ways. It came about through dictation, meaning God spoke something and told somebody, "Here is what you write." For instance, the Ten Commandments were written on stone tablets. God Himself dictated those Ten Commandments to Moses. The Bible says that people had visions and dreams, and so God revealed Himself and inspired His Word through visions and dreams. Some people heard God's voice audibly, and God inspired the Bible that way at times. Now, sometimes it's a more common method. For instance, if you go read Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, Luke talks about the historical research that he did, how he interviewed people and listened to eyewitness accounts, and then he read records of what happened in the life of Jesus Christ, and he was very careful to write down everything that happened in the life of Jesus that he could find. And God inspired Luke through the Holy Spirit to write the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. There's also eyewitness accounts. Peter writes and tells us what he saw. John, if you read the epistle of 1 John, John says, that which we've heard with our ears, we've seen with our eyes, we've touched it, that we declare unto you. And so John lets us know that he was an eyewitness to those things. And so the Bible uses a lot of different methods, but God worked through human authors and inspired them through His Holy Spirit, working through those human authors to write an inerrant and infallible word that you can believe, receive, accept, and put into practice in your life. The inspired Word of God. Now let me read you a passage out of the Old Testament, out of Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18. This is God speaking to and through Moses. Remember, Moses is the one who went up on Mount Sinai and who received the Ten Commandments directly from God. And listen to what God says to Moses. Deuteronomy 18, 18 says, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And Moses spoke for God. There's no doubt about that. We received the Ten Commandments today through Moses. God gave them directly to Moses, and so you wouldn't really question the validity of Moses' message as coming from God. But what God told Moses is, there are going to be other prophets who come and who speak for me just like you did. And so what you find in the Old Testament is prophets who came along later and who used the phrase, thus saith the Lord. You see that often in the Old Testament, thus saith the Lord. Those prophets who claimed to be speaking for God. Now, in Deuteronomy 18, where God told Moses there are other prophets who are going to come, He also tells us and Moses how we can know whether those prophets are real or not. He says, for one thing, if what they say doesn't come true, then they're a false prophet. And so these men were speaking for God, or at least claiming to, thus saith the Lord. And they were either speaking for God or they're liars. Let me say this as we go along, and I hope you take this to heart. You can either believe all of the Bible or none of the Bible. There really isn't a middle ground. Well, same was true of those Old Testament prophets. They said, thus saith the Lord. So either you believe all that they said or really none of what they said, but there's not a lot of middle ground here. Thus saith the Lord. And they claim to be speaking for God. Now the New Testament affirms that they did. The New Testament says this, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 and 21 says this, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So Peter says this didn't come by private interpretation. And what that means is they didn't come up with this themselves. Those Old Testament prophets, they didn't make it up. They didn't come up with it all on their own. That wasn't a private interpretation. They didn't just make this up. He says that they were moved by the Holy Spirit. So how did they come up with the words of God? God inspired them in a unique way through the Holy Spirit to speak for Him in an authoritative way. Peter affirms that in the New Testament. They claimed it in the Old Testament. Peter affirms it in the New Testament. Paul does too. We read 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Listen to verses 15, 16, and 17. Verse 15 says this, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And so, what he says is this. Paul is speaking to Timothy, and he says, you've known the Holy Scriptures since you were a little child. And when he says Holy Scriptures, he's speaking about the Old Testament. Remember, at this time, the New Testament hadn't been written, hasn't been completed. So when Peter and Paul are speaking about scriptures, they are speaking about the Old Testament. And Paul tells Timothy, you've known the Old Testament, the scriptures, since you were a little bee boy. And he says that all scripture is given by inspiration of God. That word inspiration is a combination of two Greek words, theos and pneuma, or neustos. Theos means God, and neustos means wind, breath, or spirit. And so what that literally means is this. It means that the Word of God is God breathed. Those two words combined, God breathed. So the image is that God breathing out those very words, they were coming from the direct mouth of God. So Peter affirms that. Paul affirms it and tells Timothy that same truth, that the Old Testament is the inspired Word of God. But we see that same idea of inspiration and authority carry from the Old Testament into the New Testament. Let me give you the words of Jesus Christ as He spoke about the inspiration of the New Testament. I'm going to read you out of John chapter 14, John chapter 15, John chapter 16. I'm going to read you a few different verses out of three different chapters. All of these chapters are Jesus preparing His disciples. Jesus is about to be crucified on the cross. He wants His disciples to be prepared when He's gone and to know what to expect. And so before He dies, He is issuing these final important words. Now listen to these words in John chapters 14, 15, and 16. John 14, 26 says this, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in My name, He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." At this time they are called the disciples. Later they are called the apostles. We're speaking about the 12. Really just 11. I hope you understand that. Judas betrayed Jesus. He wound up not being one of the 12, the 11. We call them apostles later. The word apostle means sent one. They were specifically sent and commissioned by Jesus Christ to share His message from God. And so Jesus says in John 14, 26, that as they go out and preach the message, that the Holy Spirit is going to work in them, is going to teach them, and is going to remind them of all the things that Jesus said. So God was working through those apostles by the Holy Spirit and giving them authority to speak for Jesus Christ. Listen to John 15, verses 26 and 27. "But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, He shall testify of Me, and ye shall also bear witness, because ye have been with Me from the beginning." So there's Jesus saying, you're going to bear witness of Me. The Holy Spirit is going to inspire you to do that. And He calls Him the Spirit of truth. So when the disciples were preaching the Word of God, and as they wrote the Word of God, this is truth inspired by the Holy Spirit. They were authorized to speak for Jesus in a way that I cannot, even as a preacher today. You see, my words are not authoritative. They're not the Word of God. The Bible is the Word of God. And you need to listen to a preacher if he preaches the Word of God. If he doesn't preach the Word of God, don't listen to him. I don't care who he is. And so Jesus says the disciples are going to, the apostles later, are going to be sent and commissioned by Jesus, inspired by the Holy Spirit to speak on His behalf. Listen to John 16, 13. "Howbeit when He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth, for He shall not speak of Himself, but whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak, and He will show you things to come." So there's the Holy Spirit speaking because God has revealed it to Him, and the Holy Spirit is going to inspire the apostles to speak, moved along by God Himself. The apostles spoke for Jesus, and they were giving us direct revelation from Almighty God. Now I'm going to give you an example from the Old Testament, which the Bible claims to be the Word of God, to the words of Jesus, which certainly we would accept as the Word of God, and into Paul. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 says this, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." That's Genesis chapter 2. That's speaking about Adam and Eve, but laying the foundation for all of us that man, marriage is meant to be between a man and a woman, and they marry, they leave their father and mother, they cleave unto each other, they become one flesh. Jesus quotes this same verse in Matthew chapter 19, verse 5. Jesus quotes that verse from the Old Testament. You know, Jesus affirmed the Old Testament a lot. He talked about Jonah being a real person, spoke about Adam and Eve being real persons, and talked about Noah. Jesus affirmed the teachings of the Old Testament and quoted Scripture. As a matter of fact, when he was in Matthew chapter 4, when he's tempted in the wilderness by Satan, he combats Satan by quoting Scripture himself. Jesus affirmed all of the Old Testament, but he carried that authority from the Old Testament as the Word of God into the New Testament. So Genesis chapter 24, quoted by Jesus in Matthew chapter 19, verse 5. That same verse is then quoted again in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 31 by the Apostle Paul. As he talks about marriage and teaches us, he quotes that exact same verse. So there is the authority of the Old Testament carried into the teachings of Jesus Christ and then the teachings of the Apostle Paul all the way through from Old Testament to New. The Word of God is authoritative. Those men spoke for God. The New Testament affirms that fact, that the New Testament is just as much the Word of God as the Old Testament is. Listen to what Peter says about it. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 15 and 16, Peter says this, "An account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. As also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction." There's a lot in there. But what Peter says is this. He says a few things. One of these ought to comfort you, and that's this. Peter says that Paul wrote, and some of his writings are hard to understand. So, if you read the Bible and you don't understand all of it the very first time you read it, don't be alarmed. Peter says that he himself read Paul and some of those things were hard to be understood. So, take comfort. Read the Bible. Keep reading it. You'll get it. What he says, though, is this. That there were people in Paul's day and Peter's day that would take the Bible, he uses the word rest, W-R-E-S-T, like wrestle, grapple. And what he is indicating is this, that they would take the Bible and they would twist it and they would contort it to mean something that it didn't mean in order to fit their own theology and their own agenda. They were false teachers who would take the teachings of the Old Testament, twist and contort those teachings like you would if you were in a wrestling match, to twist those things and contort those things to mean something that it really didn't, but it fit their own doctrine, their own theology, and their own agenda. And he uses a phrase here that I want you to pay attention to. He says that they take the writings of Paul and twist them just like they do other scriptures. So what Peter is saying is that the Old Testament is the Word of God, but so is the writing of the Apostle Paul. And false prophets, false teachers would twist the Old Testament, they would twist the words of Paul to try to fit their own theology and their own agenda and their own doctrine rather than taking it for what it means and what it says. The Old Testament's the Word of God, so is the New Testament. Isaiah spoke for God, so did the Apostle Paul. Well, the Apostle Paul spoke for God. His writings are Scripture. Peter says that. But listen to what Paul has to say about it then. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 18, Paul wrote this, and he says, "For the Scripture saith, Thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the laborer is worthy of his reward." Now here, Paul does something interesting. He combines an Old Testament teaching and a New Testament teaching that you shouldn't muzzle an ox as it's treading out the corn, the grain. That's an Old Testament teaching means you shouldn't put a muzzle on an ox while it's treading out the grain. While it's treading the grain, you should let it eat a little bit of it as it goes. He's talking about preachers, by the way, and paying them, but that's a whole other Bible study for a whole other night. He says that this Old Testament principle. And then he says, the laborer is worthy of his reward. That's not an Old Testament teaching. That's a New Testament teaching. Jesus said this stuff. So he's saying that the Old Testament and the New Testament are all the Word of God, that the words of Jesus Christ are the Word of God. Peter says that. Paul says that. Here's what the author of Hebrews says about Jesus Christ. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by His Son. That's Jesus. And what the author of Hebrews says is that in the Old Testament, God spoke in a lot of different ways at a lot of different times. And He did. And God spoke in a lot of different ways at a lot of different times, but He has spoken to us most fully and most completely through His Son, Jesus Christ. All of the Bible is pointing us to Jesus. That's why you can believe all of it. It's all the Word of God. Now, there are a lot of other appeals that you can make to believe the Bible. For instance, there's the historical accuracy of the Bible, the fact that it talks about people, places, and events that we know occurred from other historical records besides the Bible. And so there's the historical accuracy of the Bible. There's the logical consistency of the Bible. The fact that the Bible was written by dozens of different authors over hundreds of years, really even thousands, but over hundreds of years. And it was written by dozens of authors over hundreds of years, in different languages, at different times, in different cultures, in different countries, and all of it has one central message. All of it agrees, even though it was written over hundreds of years, dozens of authors, different languages, different cultures, different countries, it agrees from start to finish all the way through. The logical consistency of the Bible. You couldn't do that with any other book anywhere. You couldn't get dozens of writers over hundreds of years to write about the same thing and all agree, but the Bible does. There's historical accuracy, there's logical consistency, there's fulfilled prophecy. The fact that Isaiah prophesies something and then 700 years later we have Jesus Christ being born of a virgin. And so the Bible prophesies things and then later we see those events occur. So all of those things, they bolster our belief in the Word of God. But there's a reason I didn't start with those. None of those are our highest authority. Let me take a second just to warn you about something. There's a dangerous trend today. I don't know that it is new to today, but it certainly occurs today. There's a dangerous trend for us to want to appeal to science to prove the Bible, or for us to use logic and reason and philosophy to prove the Bible, or for us to use experience as an appeal to the Bible. And so we use all these different areas to try to prove the Bible. And if only we could use science, then we could prove the Bible. Or maybe you would appeal to geological studies. And if they could dig up, if they could dig up the walled city of Jericho, which, by the way, they think they have now, they found that. But anyway, if they could dig up Jericho, then we could believe the Bible. And somehow, in our minds, these other areas are greater authorities than the Bible itself. I want to tell you something. The Bible was true before any scientist ever said so or said it wasn't true. The Bible was true before any geologist ever dug up any ancient walled city. The Bible was true before logic and reason ever existed in your mind. The Bible was true before you ever experienced anything. Leave those other areas and look to the Word of God. Science may prove the Bible to some degree, but I'm going to tell you something. What I would rather see us do is not use science to prove the Bible, but use the Bible to prove science. Rather than using logic to prove the Bible, although there's nothing wrong with science, nothing wrong with logic, we should use those things, but rather than using logic to prove the Bible, I would rather use the Bible to prove our logic. I would rather all those other areas be subject and subservient to the Word of God. That is our ultimate authority. That is our ultimate truth. The Bible is God's Word, and let everything else be underneath God's Word. There is a therefore at the end of this message. If this is true, that the Bible from start to finish, from cover to cover, from Genesis to Revelation, if it is the Word of God, and it is, then there's a therefore. The Bible's the Word of God, therefore, to disobey or to disbelieve the Word of God, the Bible, is to disobey or to disbelieve God Himself. Now, the opposite's also true. To obey and to believe the Bible is to believe and obey God Himself. We are obligated to believe all of Scripture, all that it teaches, because it is all the Word of God. Listen, we are in a world right now that seems uncertain and unsure. But there are some truths that you can build your life around, and they will never shake, they will never crumble, they will never fail. You need to build your life on the Word of God and nothing else. Will you join with me today? Read the Bible, trust it, believe it, obey it. I promise you, you'll never regret it if you obey and believe God. Thank you for tuning in. God bless.